follows. Unfortunately, as I'm no longer employed by Royal Met College, my membership of the board cannot continue. I'd just like to say it's been a pleasure to know and work with you, and wish you all the very best for the future. Regards, Ryan. Can I suggest that we ask the Director of Pensions to write on behalf of the board to Robbie to thank him for all the effort and interest that he's shown on his board, because he did actually show an awful lot of interest and made a very positive contribution. Don't crazy you could write to Robbie on behalf of that, that'd be much appreciated.
Agreed.
Yeah, so
you
did that.
Can we go to the minutes of our own declaration of interest? Pecuniary and non-pecuniary interest? No declarations? Okay, can we go to the minutes page by page? I mean, I'll just call out the page if anyone has an issue. Please share it on page 1. 2. 3. 4. Therefore, can we go to item C, which is the LGPS update?
Yes, there are two reports. Sorry, just one report that was taken to the Pensions Committee since the board last met. That was the committee report.
Sorry.
Well, great timing. We're just about to do 1, 2, 3, so you can save me the trouble.
The LGPS update confirms that the Enterprise Act 2016 came into force in February, which is the primary legislation introduced in the 95K exit cap. There's still no published deadline for the introduction of the cap, as the secondary legislation is still being finalised. It also covers the Treasury's consultations on GMP and pension scams. The Fund responded to both of these consultations and they are attached to the report. The Fund's response to the GMP consultation focuses on the need for simplicity, as the interactions of GMPs with LGPS are very technical and members do not understand the impact on their pensions. The Fund supports the option to convert GMPs into scheme benefits, but as there's extra liabilities on the LGPS, we raise the question as to whether any additional funding will be available from the government. The costs around have been estimated at around $1 billion. And that equates to around 0.3% of scheme liabilities and an increase of around 0.1% of pay over a 20-year recovery period. The response to the pension scam consultation supported three measures to tackle unauthorised transfers by banning cold calling, limiting rights to statutory transfers, and making it harder to open fraudulent schemes. To strengthen controls, for all transfer requests to DC schemes, we send out scorpion leaflets alerting members to pitfalls of unauthorised transfers. And where members do opt to transfer, we require all members to provide evidence that they have received independent advice from an FCA registered financial advisor who is also qualified to give advice on transfers. They're the main points I wanted to cover, but happy to take any questions. Thanks, Chair.
Thank you.
Thanks, Chair. Yvonne, freedom of choice for ADCs, I know that's been covered in terms of consultation, but has there been any decision or conclusion on that?
No, we're still waiting for the regulations to come through. It's my understanding that the government might do a further consultation and remove that aspect of the regulations together with the Fair Deal, because there's a lot holes and gaps in them regulations. So as at this point in time, there's been no indication of when we're going to receive any consultation, further consultation around.
But presumably people could transfer their ADCs to some other pension provider that provided drawdown.
Yeah, but I think that what this is around is basically when you're still employed, that you can actually draw down your ADC. But if you leave the fund, you can actually transfer the bond. Mm. I think what's changed here is where previously, if you transferred your ADC, you have to transfer your main scheme benefits, but now they've split the cord between two. So you can transfer your ADC out, but you can leave your scheme, your main benefits in the scheme, but you have to actually have terminated your employment to do that.
Ah, right, okay.
So that's the difference.
Great, thanks for that.
Questions? It's on page 9. I think it's an example that the board is being treated seriously and properly by the administrative authority. It's in 1.2 that Yvonne did seek my views on both of those consultations before they were sent off, as well as the chair of the pensions committee. So we were consulted, and I did actually read and actually did have discussions.
Yeah, you made changes to the responses and put them on board, and it was very helpful what you said, that we did take on board what you asked us to put in and amend.
We are, you know, assuming we are being consulted, that is positive and something which I don't know what the practice is elsewhere, but I suspect it is probably not a practice common for you. So,
I think also because we are a larger fund, we do try and respond to all the consultations, even though sometimes it's very, pressured in resources, but we do try and respond, especially to something like GMP, which is going to have a massive impact on members and also pension scandal. We do try all the time and respond to any consultations.
I think that is important because I think many LGPSs don't, I think because of resource constraints.
Yeah.
In fact, it's not the technical expertise. But I mean, these two, the pension scam, for individuals have potential huge impacts. We know that, literally, I think the scorpion is a good thing to use because this is what these people are. They are predators, they are dangerous predators.
Yeah.
And the GMP is actually, again, from a fund point of view, is actually an administrative nightmare.
It is.
And,
it's a lot, I've said in the presentation that a lot of members don't understand, but a lot of, it's quite a technical feature of the LGPS, and a lot of administrators find it hard to get to grips with as well. It is a really technical aspect. And with the state pension scheme, when you move in the additional state pension, the new scheme, it's going to have a massive impact. It's very easy to respond on that. It's going to be paying pensions increases on their own to their pensions.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Chair. I thought I'd pull a short report together for the Pension Board on the way in which the valuation process took place and the process that was followed. Clearly the Board is concerned about governance, and the intention is to provide assurance to the Pension Board about the various things that were put in place. Under Section 2, I just remind members about the purpose of an actuarial valuation. The administering authority needs to determine the expected cost of providing the benefits built up by members, the contributions needed to cover the cost of the benefits that active members will build up in the future, and then finally an appropriate plan for making up the shortfall if the fund is in deficit. So fundamental to the valuation results is the funding strategy, and as I mentioned, this is set out in the funding strategy statement, which is one of the key documents that the fund And there's also an important interrelationship between the funding strategy statement and the investment strategy statement. There is a separate report about the investment strategy statement on this agenda, but effectively the investment strategy statement sets out the investment strategy, and it's from that allocation that the actuary derives the expected returns in the future for the fund. Although the investment strategy is kept under regular review at the quarterly investment monitoring working party meetings, the actuarial valuation, which takes place on a three-yearly basis, is a very fundamental review of the process. 2.4, the most significant consideration was the move to a CPI-linked valuation basis. Based on the actuary's assumptions, our investment consultants undertook a review of the investment strategy. They modelled cash flows, they looked at investment returns and the correlations between the different assets that we have and the asset allocation, and they provided a stochastic projection of the funded status, which is really one of those funnels of doubt that you've probably seen. So it gives you an indication of the likelihood of certain outcomes. There was a detailed discussion with officers, and the chair of the board attended that meeting as well with the investment consultant to consider these matters, and the revised asset allocation became effective from April this year. Happy if there are any questions, or unless the chair would like to comment on that as well.
Thank the director for inviting to that meeting with the investment consultants, because again, it was an opportunity to see exactly how the strategy was put together. And I think the positive thing to report is that the fund was not led by the investment consultant. The investment consultant was consulted by the fund, and that's the way it should be, and that's the way it was. Very positive from my point of view, and a lot of issues and matters the director asked the consultants to provide the information reports on, and as he said in the meeting, he would then take those back to the investment working party, and in that group, where the members sit and where the independent advisors are, those things will be further discussed and decisions reached, which is the appropriate one. That's all really I'm not saying, but also just to remind ourselves that at the next meeting, and it's recorded in the minutes on page 3, the director will bring along a report to the board on the process that was followed in coming to that investment strategy. And that's, you'll see that that's on page 3 of the minutes. So the next meeting we'll get a report on the process followed. That's all I'm about to say. Anyone else have any thoughts or comments? Draft pension strategy.
Thank you, Chair. Issue 41 of the revised PAS attached as an appendix to the report. Following the board review and pensions committee approval of the changes, there will be a consultation with employers from the middle of July to the end of September. The reason for the review is to improve data quality and efficiencies and time scales. The policy covers admin standards, performance measures and communications with employers, and sets out the responsibilities of the fund and employers. As there is significant work to comply with the regulatory requirements, both parties need to work in partnership. As you know, all of the public sector is under pressure to manage its costs, and therefore we must look closely at any non-statutory resource-intensive admin work. The regs allow us to recover cost incurred due to poor performance or charge employers who demand a disproportionate amount of fund rewards. The charges for underperformance relate to late submission of monthly or annual returns, and where submissive files have errors greater than a 5% tolerance level. Employers will also be charged for the provision of additional pension calculations in excess of statutory requirements or bespoke administration tasks. The revised PAS will be applicable from April 2018, and the Council's Section 151 officer has had the opportunity to comment on the report and has authorised it for publication. My recommendation is that board members consider the pass on the proposed charge and schedule. Thank you, Chair.
Any questions or comments?
Are we going to forecast if likely income you'll get from those charges based on
My ears are terrible for a bad infection, I can't hear it. I'm sorry, Dad.
Have you done any projections on what the likely income would be based on current performance with employers?
Well, at the moment, we do have a number. It's not really about income bringing income in, it's around streamlining resources. We have a number of employers who do submit annual returns late. And what this charge, we're only charging a nominal £250, obviously, for any additional work that we have to do because the data's poor. But what it's really around is around helping the fund to meet its statutory responsibilities and provision of annual benefit statements. And so when TPR look at our data quality, that we're not in breach of providing correct information to members. So we'll leave it there as essential measure, and we will be incurring charges for the additional work that we've had to do in chasing and reconciling data. It's more around this, that we can meet our statutory requirements, but that was under the penalty side of it. But around, there is also information in there to say we will be charging for additional non-statutory work. When people ask us for multiple estimates, well, the regulations, the disclosure regulations say we only have to provide one estimate a year, we'll be adhering to that. People ask for multiple estimates, we'll charge them for that. In relation to transfer value, you're only entitled to one cash equivalent a year, so we'll charge anything over that. So it's around staff resource, and also for when your employers come into the fund, we have lots of academies coming in, or when people leave the fund, there's a lot of work that the fund has to undertake, and it's really about balancing that resource amongst the rest of the employers, because why should the rest of the funds pay for all resource that we're providing to one particular employer? So it's around that, and obviously to recouping our costs for that.
Thanks, Chair. Donald, very nitpicky this. Page 54 of the pack. Section 10, Employer's Guide for Administration, HR Guide for Employers. It says effective from 1st of April 2014.
Yeah,
is that because of previous?
Yeah, it's because the guide is in relation to administering this new scheme, and the new scheme came in.
I see. Okay. All right, thanks for that. Yeah.
It's just the PAS is coming in 2018. I'm just trying to warn employers that we're moving quite radically from our previous approach to really will be charged, and that'll be from employee. But that's
but it says April 14th.
Yeah, well, that's around how we administer the scheme. That's around HR guidance because of the care scheme coming in 2014,
right.
And all the transitional protections
okay.
of
right.
how you administer that way.
Okay, I've got that. Thanks.
After pension board, if they've got any comments that they think any of these charges are unfair or the timescales are unfair, we'll then take it to pension board for them to pension committee on the 17th of July, for them to approve the draft strategy for us to take it out of consultation, and we'll open the consultation for 2 months, and following that we'll look at we'll ask for committee's approval for the officers to be delegated responsibility to feedback on the responses. We'll consider what the employers say, and then we will take it back to Pensions Committee in November with our proposed responses, and then it'll become formal then in April 18th. So it'll go out to consultation, go to committee July. Can we take this to consultation? I'll go to consultation July till September. We'll evaluate the responses, take it back to committee in November for the committee to approve the final version. We'll publicise it to employers and say, this is where you are at the moment. And if you don't meet these performance levels from April, you're going to get these charges. We know we're going to be charging for additional administration work. So it's not a shock to everybody, basically. So I think get the ducks in a row.
Are you planning on doing it kind of workshops face to face or just for electronic feedback?
No, I think it'll be just electronic feedback. Rather than when we do the funding strategy statement, we'll be done a number of consultations face to face, but we're really planning to do this through electronic.
Just for a point of clarity, on page 56, which is the back page of the draft pensions administration strategy, it does actually, it's a bit presumptuous of me because I prepared the draft, sorry, but it says approved by pensions committee in November 2017. That's the plan that Yvonne's just outlined. Of course, really, it should say, it shouldn't actually have that date there.
But we're not saying what the consensus is going to be the same.
No, it isn't.
It'll obviously have changed after.
It was me preparing the draft.
We do keep a list of who's returned these discretions, and admittedly, there are some employees that haven't returned all the discretions. We do actively chase them. I've just looked at it today, to be honest, before coming to the meeting, and there's a few employees that haven't. So I've just had a discussion with some of the benefit managers and communications team to say we need to be taking more of a robust approach to this now. We're in breach. We will be in breach with BC in breach of our statutory duties. So I'm going to take the line now. If you don't send me all your published policies, I'm not paying any retirement pensions out for anybody. Even though some of them discretions, some of the retirement pensions that we're paying out now, often aren't covered by the discretion because they're not on flexible retirement. They're not saying, you know, wave actuated reduction. But I think I'm going to have to take the line now because some of these are outstanding since April 14 and that. And you don't issue your published discretions to me, I will have to consider not processing any time benefits for the staff. I've got to take some robust measure.
Because they need to provide these, because the employees who are considering their position need to know what the position is.
Yeah.
And the employer hasn't produced them, and how can the employee make the decision? I also noticed that I think it's helpful that you providing a report to this board on charges levied and outstanding payments, which I think we will welcome. If we can give any assistance in actually putting this into place, that would be good. I mean, the recommendation is there. I mean, are you, you know, content with this report and that it goes forward for consultation?
Great.
Except with the charge and policy that I've put in, I can expect them to get prepared. I mean, obviously, we'll revise this as things move forward. This is the initial charges, expected charges. I don't know what employees are going to come back with them. I think it's, you know, it's not equitable, it's not fair, they won't have a charge, but we'll have a come into consultation.
Maybe you prepare some of your stuff online. Will employees have the opportunity rather than asking you then be able to maybe do some of the calculations themselves? Is that the proposal?
Some of the larger employers now do their own estimates online. Some of them do, but it depends what calculations that they're doing. If they're just doing normal voluntary retirements, they will do them. But if there's flexible retirements, they'll often come back to the fund because there's complications depending on what category new member you are. If there's an ABC involved, they can't do it, they need to come back to the fund because we have to decide, well, we have to go to the ABC provider to find out what the fund value, give the member a number of options around what they're going to do. So the same calculations that we always do. But you're right, there is facilities on there.
Yeah.
And there will be, you know, there's facilities for members on member self-service to do very, very rough calculations. So that is our model to move forward.
Sorry, Juan, just on that. So maybe it's the case that there are a number of employers who could be doing stuff online who aren't. So is that therefore sort of an education process for some of the employers?
We do, and we often bring employers in, and we do, you know, to show them how to access. of doing the calculations, any pitfalls, but some of them, some employers, if we look at the history in 2014, we used to pay employers to do estimates, and we decided to take that function back in-house. We didn't decide to take the function back in-house, we just haven't paid it anymore, because when we had a broader look around the LGPS, other administration authorities were asking employers to do some estimates and they weren't paying them, and because, as I said, we're under resource constraints, we decided to take the money back from the local authorities, and a lot of that we would ask them to promote the scheme, and then payments were historic payments, we would ask them employers to go and promote the scheme, but now in the event that we've got our website, a lot of the promotion around the scheme is through the
We do regular training sessions, etc. So we have one of the larger employers who does have access to employee services, to computer system. Who, you know, there's been a changeover of staff, or, you know, bring them in and train them in. As Yvonne has said, you know, explain the pitfalls, you know, things to watch out for. So,
okay, thank you.
Just in terms of this, I think you know, the starting point of this is to ensure that we're here for the pensioners who contribute to the scheme and have the benefit of the scheme. And I think that the charging, you know, can be to a degree potentially, you know, controversial, but it's about a partnership with the employers. And I think whilst Yvonne has said, you know, clearly, you know, consider the charges as they are, but we're not operating as a commercial outfit here. If we were, I think these charges would probably be a bit higher, to be honest with you. So it's not about making profits, it's about just recovering costs. And particularly where there are duplications and alternatives such as online, and it is about nudging people, nudging the employers, and also ultimately nudging our pensioners to more efficient ways of working, because our judgment will be based on our administrative overheads, and the more we can do to reduce that and actually pay the pensioners A, efficiently, but B, at low cost, then that's what we're trying to do.
Misuse the opportunities that are there in terms of obtaining information, you know, multiple requests, etc. And it has to be, I think, you know, people need to think before they act. Any consent with?
I think you're okay. Thank you. Investment strategy, Sam, please.
Yes, thank you, Chair. In the last board meeting, we brought the guidance in relation to the investment strategy statement. This time, the report provides members with a copy of the investment strategy statement that was approved at March Pensions Committee. The report, the actual statement is attached as an appendix, but just going through section two again to remind you about the statutory background. The ISS replaces the statement of investment principles. There are a number of items that the statement is required to cover. The requirement to invest money in a wide variety of investments. The authority's assessment of the suitability of particular investments. The authority's approach to risk. Obviously, a new item was the authority's approach to pooling of investments, which hadn't been included in the previous regulations. The authority's policy on social, environmental and corporate governance considerations, and finally the authority's policy on the exercise of rights. So things around stewardship and around responsible investment were strengthened in the guidance around the investment strategy statement. There's also a requirement to set maximum percentages for the total value of all investments of fund money that will be invested in particular investments or classes of investment. I don't propose to go through the statement, but it's there if there are any questions. Just a very current update. Well, one element of the guidance was around restrictions on admission authorities from divesting and boycotting or using the pension fund assets. That was challenged in the High Court, and the Secretary of State was overruled by the High Court, so the judicial review ruled that the Secretary of State went beyond the powers he has in effectively using regulations for non-pension purposes. Effectively, what he said in the guidance was that the investment strategy that pension funds had should be consistent with the country's foreign policy, so we shouldn't boycott nations that the country wasn't boycotting, but simply we could boycott countries if there was a boycott in place. But I say that's been overruled. We're just waiting for some clarification, but presumably that element of the guidance is struck out. But on the basis we didn't codify that in our statement, it has no implications for us.
Sure, I've just got a question on page 69. The fund actually, it says fund actions identified the following risk, and it says longevity continues to increase at a greater rate than anticipated. The meeting that we had with the actuaries, I thought they said that people were actually, were dying sooner, so, and that's why some of the funding had gone up. So that looked like a little bit of contradiction. I'm just making sure that I had that right.
Yeah. No, you're quite right. Yeah. I think the actuary is saying if he got his estimation of longevity wrong, then that's a risk, and it's quite an expensive risk to the fund, that if he underestimates it, you're quite right. It's interesting that the most recent data suggests that the rate of improvement in longevity has slowed more quickly than the forecast.
Right.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Any other thoughts?
Just in terms of the oversight
board,
in terms of what that might, what developments are on that board.
Yes, well, there's something called the Scheme Advisory Board, which was in shadow form originally and now is formally constituted. So that's looking at the LGPS at an entire level. In terms of the Oversight Board, this is specific to the Northern Pool, so that we're proposing to have a joint committee as an oversight board. That won't be the same for every pool, but the way that we're structuring our pool, the joint committee will be comprised of three representatives from each of the three funds in the pool. There'll be two elected members and there'll be one employer representative. And as you can see, the purpose of the Oversight Board is really like either the committee or the pension board in holding the pool to account. Mm-hmm. So it's not a decision-making body, but it's there to ensure that the pool is implementing the instructions and decisions made by each of the administrative authorities. Is that clear, or would you like to say
is
a bit more about
it? Can it be the same members as the boards that are in place, will there be a joining of different board members across that pool, or is it going to be a totally separate?
No, the elected members will be from the pension committees. So it will be the chair of each committee and another elected member representative. The employer representatives may well be different.
Thoughts or comments? No? Thank you. The report?
Yep.
Transparency first.
Yes, thank you, Chair. This report provides members with details of the Code of Transparency recently announced by the Scheme Advisory Board. It's long been recognised that in addition to the fees paid for investment management, there have been further hidden costs incurred that are difficult to ascertain and so are rarely reported in most pension fund accounts. There have been a number of initiatives around this, and the pension fund has been a long-standing supporter of transparency in all areas of corporate governance. Great believer that if something's reported, then it can be measured. If it can be measured, then it can be managed. And that's true for things like carbon emissions from companies through to investment management costs. In 2015, when DCLG set out its criteria for pooling, one of the criteria is around cost savings, and DCRG were quite clear that those cost savings needed to be reported transparently and benchmarked to demonstrate that there was value for money in terms of the performance being achieved. And then very recently, the 18th of May, the Scheme Advisory Board announced proposals for encouraging greater fee transparency by investment managers. At the moment, it's limited to investment managers managing listed equities, that's equities and bonds. It's a voluntary code, but the proposal is that the investment manager signs up and then automatically provides cost information to the administering authority on a regular basis. And any investment manager doing that will effectively get a kite mark. So there's an incentive for them to do it, to say that they're following best practice, and there's an incentive for the LGPS to encourage it, because it will make it easier for us to collect that kind of information. Donna's team has been doing a lot of work on this already, so it might help in terms of getting information from some of our managers, but the challenge still remains with alternative investment managers which aren't covered by this code, and where it is more difficult to ascertain the costs. As a Northern Pool, we've been working hard on it, and as a fund, we've been working hard in terms of collecting that information. We collected it for our original pooling submission because we needed to set a benchmark, you know, of what our costs are. And then, as I say, going forward, we'll be reporting against that benchmark cost to demonstrate that pooling is delivering cost savings. As I say, under Section 8, the identification and collation of investment costs is resource intensive, particularly in the area of unquoted investments. So in that area, you know, the fund is going above and beyond really what this transparency code covers, and we are devoting considerable amounts of staff time and other resources to this exercise. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Chair. Peter, albeit this code is not mandatory, can we mandate our investment managers to follow it? And can we do that for alternative investments as well?
No is the short answer.
Oh.
I mean, clearly
why not?
We can put pressure on them and we can suggest to them that their mandate won't be renewed.
Mm.
But the reality is that sometimes, you know, if a manager is performing very well, one wouldn't cut off one's nose to spite one's face.
Understood. But would it be something we would push stronger when we were employing a new manager?
Yes, very much so. No, you're quite right that there'll be, not be helpful that the LGPS funds will be collaborating on engaging with their existing investment managers, and I think, as you say, other investment managers will recognise that it's something they should do in order to meet expectations. And in terms of alternatives, a lot of work's actually been done by Dutch pension funds. So they've been doing this for a number of years. We've been engaging more recently, but it's helpful that there are some industry approaches. It's always helpful because if there are a number of different initiatives, there are different approaches and different data requirements. And although a standard template may not give you exactly everything you want, it's a really good start, and it is getting quite a bit of traction.
So, putting aside unlisted, whereby there is not a national initiative, and that's going to be more difficult, as you said, Peter. In terms of this initiative, what exactly is the Merseyside Pension Fund's approach likely to be then to its listed asset managers? What are you likely to say or not say to them at the beginning?
Well, certainly, we meet with them regularly anyway, and we will be asking them to sign up to the code.
So basically, the Merseyside approach is positive there. You'll be asking your managers to sign up. It's up to them whether they do, but a clear message is going to go out from the fund that you expect that.
and the reality is we're getting this information off them already, so it's not as if they're not providing us with the information, but it's more, it's something that would be more helpful perhaps the smaller funds to get it, dare I say, given to them on a plate rather than, you know, literally writing dozens and dozens of letters every year to managers seeking information and then going through report and accounts and verifying that information against their published information and so on and so forth. And we're still, dare I say, you know, we're only halfway there. There is more to be done, but we have made enormous progress over the last 2 or 3 years.
Can we put any instance that if you don't sign up, we wouldn't utilise them?
Well, I think that's what Patrick was suggesting, but...
I know what you're saying, you can't cross off on them.
No. But they will recognise, that it's in their interest to do that. But they're required to provide us with the information. It's more, it'll be done, as I say, it'll be done on a proactive basis by them rather than reactive to us asking for information.
I think the other very positive thing about this, Kelly, is though it's voluntary, it was agreed in consultation with the Investment Association, which is their trade body. So the fact that it's been agreed as a trade body means a number of managers have already signed, I think there's five, isn't it, Peter, as of yesterday, or five. There's peer pressure on them. Because their own trade body has agreed to this, you know, if your trade body agrees to it, you're under pressure. Because you can't say, well, I don't agree with this because that member's a trade body. So I think they're going to be under huge pressure to do it. And as Peter said, with pooling coming, I think there's even more pressure. Because we know in this pool, you know, listed assets are going to be treated in a particular segregated way, but I think in other pools, the costs are different. They're very low here in terms of listed. In other pools, we're at higher because they don't have internal management. Internal management keeps it lower here. Where it's all externally managed elsewhere, there's going to be a lot of pressure to bring down fees, and there still is a lot more than dual experience because the fees are already lower. So I think, you know, these managers are under a lot of pressure. And I think they'll get the ones who want to stay in the game will cooperate. They really will. Because I think they'll have no choice. Now, the LGIM, who are one of your managers, it's probably the second biggest manager, aren't they, you know, by assets in terms of the size of this company. They've signed up. LGIM has signed up. Barry Gifford, who probably managed probably almost more LGPS funds than anybody, they've signed up. So two of the very big ones have signed up right at the beginning, and I think the others will follow. Mm-hmm. Can I just ask one more question, please? One of the concerns about this code is that you get information managers, which actually is interpreting them, and there is a concern that some funds may have difficulties interpreting that information. What do you think is one of the positions on their side in terms of actually being able to physically, when that lands on your desk in the standard format, the ability to actually make sense of it, because there is a question mark over whether all funds will be able to, or have the staff that can understand that, and what's your feeling about that?
It's important, as you say, that data is seen in context. We make use of an external organisation called CEM, who effectively benchmark costs not only against other LGPS funds, but against the pensions industry more widely. So it's a very helpful report